that you travel on. There's one day here and the next day gone. Sometimes you bend, sometimes you stand, sometimes you turn your back to the wind. There's a world outside every darkened door where blues won't haunt you anymore. Where the brave are free and lovers soar. Come ride with me to the distant shore. We won't hesitate to break down the garden gate. There's not much time left today.
Alright, 6 minutes after 10 o'clock, Matt Gibbs is in the studio. It's time for his show, Auto Repair with Personal Care, and your phone calls. Matt, of course, is a mechanic and an automotive technician. I like that. From Sunrise Automotive, he comes in each week to answer our questions about our cars. The phone number to call Matt right now is the WOCA Climate Control Source Hotline. 352 is the area code. The rest of the number is 622-9622. Good morning, Matt.
Good morning, Larry.
Are you ever at a stoplight?
All the time.
And you park next to a vehicle, and you're looking at that vehicle, and you're saying, man, that's the life I want. Never. See, this happened to me the other day, and it wasn't a car. It was one of those Jeeps. I mean, nothing, and like you might have thought I was going to say some Corvette or some fancy, sexy car, but this Jeep, that would be me. You know?
Well, it could be you.
Yeah, I should get a Jeep.
You should.
So, what do you think about a Jeep? Is it a good car?
That's what I'm
You're in a Jeep.
I'm in a Jeep.
See?
I retired my old van.
See, I've always known that we had some kind of a kindred spirit on here.
Yes, yes.
So what made you want a Jeep?
The price.
Oh, Jeeps are cheap?
No. I just happened to stumble across a deal.
Oh, okay. But I mean the big knobby tires, the fact that you can open up the whole thing. Who cares about air conditioning anyway?
Well, I got a Jeep Cherokee, but you're talking about like a Wrangler or something.
I guess. Yeah, I don't know. Yeah. It just looked like, you know, that I want that to be my... I want a car where you don't have to break the window to break in. If you want to break in, it's open. You know?
No, when I'm driving down the road, and if I stop at a stoplight and see a car, it's like, oh, man, that's that car that had the blown head gaskets in it.
Oh, yeah. Right, in your world, yeah. Yeah, you know all the problems, yeah.
Well, it was funny you even mentioned it. Yesterday after church, we went to lunch, and then me and my wife had to go to Walmart and get a few things, and I pulled into the parking spot, and it was and right next to the car we parked next to was a car that we had just worked on. And I was telling my wife,
really?
Yeah, that car. I know that car pretty good.
So it's never a never-ending learning experience for you. You are learning what's under a hood of a car, something new every day?
All the time.
Or maybe not every day, but quite frequently,
all the time.
Huh?
It's like I was just talking to one of my buddies at the Cadillac store, and they just sold it's a brand new Cadillac, 2013 Cadillac they just sold, and before they sold the car, then they were getting ready to deliver the car, and before they delivered it, he said he had 17 new downloads to download in the computer on a car that's brand new, hasn't even been sold yet.
Now why? What does that do?
For what the GM comes out and says, okay, we need to reflash or reprogram or redo and give it all these updates. And it was 17 on this car, and it hasn't even left the dealership.
Now see, that's a big difference between what you do for cars and what a doctor does for the human body. I mean, 10 years from now, the heart and the liver, it's all still gonna be in the same place.
Right.
There's
exactly.
No new downloads for you.
Right. Right. So the difference between us, and it's not even so that big of a difference between the medical field and the automotive field, is that even though our body stays the same,
right,
but the technology to be able to work on our bodies are constantly
changing. That's changed. But like, you're not going to go to a guy from New York and he's got a different body than a guy from Arizona. You know what I mean?
Right.
You're going to say, okay, there he is. I know. Right. I understand what's in here.
That's right.
But with a car, I mean, 1 year difference could make...
Oh, it's incredible. Mm. It's incredible. It's gonna definitely change. The industry is changing. You know, the technicians are changing. Everything is changing. And either you got to keep up with it or you're going to be on the outside looking in.
Do you know what really hit home for me was a statement you made a couple of weeks ago that a car is built for a certain number of miles and then... It's all good luck, sir.
That's right.
We told you 500,000 is the max, or whatever,
right,
you said,
right.
was the number.
Right. For years back in the 80s, they were
50,
built
000,
to make,
right?
Yeah, 5 years or 50,000 miles.
50,000, not 500,000. 500,000 wouldn't be bad.
That wouldn't be it. That would be a good thing. And you got to stop and think that the manufacturers want you to buy a new car. I mean, we have to have those folks that go out and buy new cars in order for there to be used cars.
Right.
So you know, it's a cycle of life in the automotive world.
All right, I have probably a very, very small question for a car guy like you, but the odometer is digital right now. How dependable is it? I mean, the old days, it was physical. A physical wheel was turning, right?
Uh-huh.
Is one more dependable than the other? As far as you're buying a car, you look at the odometer, how can you cheat the customer? You know what I mean?
Oh, you can cheat.
You can.
Oh, yeah.
Either type of odometer, yeah?
Look at, you know, you can't even put your credit card in a gas pump anymore. Somebody will figure out a way to cheat everything.
Oh, okay.
You know? So, yeah, the cheating goes on.
So, if that's an important issue, like somebody says, oh, it's like if it says 50,000 miles is the max it can do, and you're with an unscrupulous dealer who has changed that odometer to say, instead of 51, now it says 15,000.
Right.
I mean, is there a way to...
Well, yeah, there's
look it up?
Yeah, see, like, if I'm looking at a car and I'm looking at mileage, this is just me. The first thing I do is look at the brake pedal. I don't look at the odometer. I look at the brake pedal.
Really?
And then there's other things on the car that you look at to. I had one not too long ago that I knew that the car did not have the mileage that it said it did.
Oh, wow.
I
knew it didn't. Oh, wow. But is there a way to verify it? Like, is there a PIN number or something?
What
do you call it?
Well, you could go
VIN number.
A VIN number. Yeah, you can run the VIN number, and then it can do, you know, they can do some checks, and you can find out who the dealer was that maybe sold the car. You can find out when it was sold, where it was sold.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
You know, and then you can do some
piece it together a little bit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. They do that at the auctions too, and that's one of the good things. If you buy a car at the auction, then all the VIN numbers are processed. You know, if there's been any kind of accident, frame damage, uh-huh, flood uh-huh. damage, anything reported, and that's the key though. It has to have it needed to be something that was reported. They can be picked up.
Ah, okay. Yeah, the reported, like Hurricane Katrina probably left a lot of flooded cars that never got reported.
Well, if somebody got paid from an insurance claim, then they did get reported.
Oh, okay. All right, let's go to the phone. Again, Matt Gibbs is your host. Good morning, you're on with Matt.
Yeah, good morning, Matt.
Good morning.
You're sitting in your car, your parked car. The ignition is off, the car is not running, and somebody runs into you pretty hard. Are your airbags going to deploy with the ignition off?
No.
They won't. The ignition has to be on.
Yes.
Okay, I was wondering. So it's kind of, you know, it's up to you. If you're sitting there, somebody nails you, you're not going to have any protection, more or less.
Yeah, that's a real good question, too.
Where are the sensors for the airbags? Like the one in the steering wheel. Now that has to be down in front somewhere, right? Not by the steering wheel.
They're all over. When they first come out with the airbag sensors or the airbag systems,
right?
They called it a forward sensor. There's a forward sensor. There's a rear sensor.
Yeah.
Now they've got side sensors. They've got them all, and they're outside. They're, you know, behind the grill, behind
yeah.
the bumper. You know. They're putting them things all over the place nowadays.
Now, like a side by your door, by the side, if some kid would come by, or not a kid, but anybody, and give your door a good, pretty good pound with his fist, could that set that off?
Probably not with a fist.
Yeah,
it takes you know, people kind of get scared, especially technicians. You know, you're working underneath the dash, and there's a bomb sitting on the steering wheel.
Yeah.
It takes a whole lot more to deploy an airbag than you know, a bicycle running into your car or something like that.
If you have a faulty airbag system on some cars or all cars, would that show up in your dash in your computer saying airbags not functioning or something like that?
Yes, if anybody's driving around today and their airbag light is on,
okay,
their system is dysfunctional. It will not deploy.
Oh,
okay.
Would you fix something like that?
Yes.
Okay. Would it usually be the whole system or just maybe like one bag?
Yeah, well, be honest with you, probably one of the biggest problems that we have are with the seat belts.
Oh.
The seat belt, when you buckle the seat belt in,
yeah,
it actually is a part of your airbag system.
Oh.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
So in other words, you're saying that if you don't have your seat belt on when you're driving, the bag won't go off?
Nope, it'll go off. But when you plug it in, there's sensors inside the car, outside the car, on your seat belts.
Huh.
Yeah.
But some of the seat belts are designed that when there is an accident, they actually retract so that the seat belt gets tighter to hold you tied up against the seat.
Okay.
To keep you from, reducing whiplash and those
kind
of things.
Oh,
yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Okay, well, very thank you very much for your interesting answer there.
Not a problem. Thank you.
You bet. Bye now.
Bye-bye.
So that made me think of a question. I was in an accident once, and what I remember about after the impact was everything looked white. In fact, I thought, am I dead? I really had that tiny micro moment, And then everybody said, oh, what you saw was the powder from the airbag. Mm-hmm. Is that right?
Talc, yes.
So the whole...
You didn't get a funny taste in your mouth?
I don't remember. I mean, I was fine. I mean, I got out. I was injured, but I was able to walk. But I remember, like, everything went white.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that's normal. Everybody reports that?
Yeah.
I wasn't seeing the light at the end of the tunnel?
Well... I did. I shouldn't say this on the air for everybody to hear, but when they first come out, when the SRS system came out, the airbag systems came out, I had to deploy one.
You just wanted to see?
I had to see.
Oh, no.
So we actually had a car come in, and the material that, how it's on your steering wheel and how you got the rubber cover over it.
Right, right.
It was kind of distorted, and the people that bought the car, they didn't like it. They wanted it warrantied. So, and because this was when they first come out, we had to send anything related to the airbag system, if there was a fault, we had to send it back to GM because they wanted to see exactly what the condition was. But being that the airbags is an explosive device, we couldn't mail it back. We had to deploy it. So they actually sent us a special tool to take it outside.
Oh, next time you do it, I want to come and watch.
You detonate the thing and blow the thing up.
And?
Oh, we had a ball with that. But I'm telling you what, that white powdery, that's why I asked if, did you have a funny...
I don't remember it at all.
That thing, we did it backwards. We did it our way. We're a bunch of crazy guys, and we made it to where when the bag deployed, it shot it up in the air.
Oh, goodness.
That thing went about 35 feet straight up in the air.
Wow.
Just powder went.
How does
everywhere.
That not injure the person? Why they put the kids in the back seat, right?
Right. And it's soft. It's a real soft material, and you can't see it inflate and deflate. You can't see it. It happens so fast that it'll boggle your mind.
It's amazing.
Your brain can't see the bag inflate and deflate.
No, I don't remember the bag at all. I mean, I saw it hanging there. And I saw the white cloud that I thought was heaven, but I didn't.
Larry's like, I see the light. I see the light.
Well, I was thinking, you know what I was really thinking, to be honest with you? I said, no, come on, not now. I got other things still to do. That was I was asking God, please, not now. We're not ready yet. I wanted to ask you about totally different subject. I was reading an article the other day, and this guy had an old, some kind of a car. I think it was a coupe something. It probably doesn't tell you anything. But he was having trouble finding, it was on Facebook, having trouble finding opera lights.
Okay.
You know right away what that is. I said, opera lights? What the heck is an opera light in a car?
I cannot think of a car that has an opera light on it anymore.
Anymore. So he has an old coupe something. Does that sound right?
Well, yeah, it would be like a Coupe de Ville, the old Cadillac. They were in the Cadillacs and the town
cars.
So
that's a good trivia question.
What is an opera light?
What is an opera light?
First one that calls and says what an opera light is, I'll give him a free oil change.
There you go. All right, I like that. First one that calls and says what it is, because I know what it is because I looked it up. I said, what the heck is an opera light? And by the way, the cars that had opera lights also had opera windows.
Opera windows.
Right?
And
am I right about that?
I don't know.
Because that's I picked that up from the article.
I will say this. The opera lights that were on the older cars, they did not run off of 12 volts. If someone can tell me how many volts they ran off of, I'll change your oil and give you a tire rotation.
Okay. All right. If you don't know the number, it's WOCA, the WOCA Climate Control Source Hotline, 622-WOCA. So tell Matt what an opera light is. And what was the other part?
How many volts that they ran on.
So that wasn't connected to the car battery?
It was connected to the battery, but it went through another device.
I gotcha. Once we get the answer, then I have to have you explain that. Otherwise, we're going to give it away, right? So you get a tire rotation and an oil change. Which reminds me, I got to come over for an oil change. So.
Well, then answer the question.
No, I don't like to take a freebies. I like to pay for my stuff.
No, you don't. You don't, Larry.
So, but anyway, so I learned what that was now, and now we can't talk about it. We've got to wait for an answer. So anyway, go back to my Jeep.
Okay.
Do you like Jeeps?
I do.
Well, Jeep is a brand name, right?
Yes.
I'm using it like a generic word, but it's really a brand name.
Right. Okay. There's Jeep, and then there's Cherokees, and there's Wranglers. That's the make, and then they have all their models.
Do you ever get cars, like when you ever see these like army surplus things, is that a good idea or not? Like if you got a Jeep from the army surplus sale online or something like that.
I don't like them? Well, I don't really
know. They're abused or something?
I've never bought anything from one of those places to kind of say, ooh, you could get a really good deal here. I will say this. I feel sorry for some people that buy a car off of eBay. I've seen some people really, really get hurt from buying a car on eBay. Yeah.
Huh.
That hadn't worked out real good for some of the... And maybe they sell tens of thousands, and I only got to see the ones that have the problems because... If you don't have a problem, you're not going to see me.
Did you ever see that motorcycle that Dan sold on eBay? That with the sidecar?
No.
No, that pink one?
No.
No?
Our Dan?
Yeah. It was very cool. He had it up in the parking lot. Really?
No, I never saw it.
Oh, maybe he still has the photographs. It had a sidecar that was enclosed.
Wow.
It was like whoever rode in that had their own little environment with a radio, and I think had a radio. I don't know if it had air in it, but... It was like a little...
That would be pretty cool.
Capsule. And it was like pink, like breast cancer pink, you know, like that campaign. It's probably politically incorrect to say it that way, but...
No, as long as it had a little sticker on there.
But Dan is a guy who can take an old vehicle and make it look really good, and whoever buys stuff from him on eBay gets a pretty good vehicle, I think, from what I've seen.
Yeah, I never saw that.
So you've never sold stuff on eBay?
I've bought some stuff on eBay, but no, I've never really sold. And I want to because like I have like a huge room at my shop, and I've got all these brand new parts that people's never come for.
Oh well, you should sell
order
them.
And I should sell.
Oh yeah. Yeah, well, if you don't... See, I'm not a good person to ask about eBay, but Dan knows all about it.
I was trying to find somebody that would set up an eBay store, and I'd even split the profits with them.
I don't... Okay. Good morning. You're on the air with Matt.
Good morning. Opera lights and opera windows are ornamental on the sides of the car. Kind of behind the front doors.
Yeah, that's right. Yep. That's right. Wow, Alan, you just got an oil change. Now, do you know how many volts they took?
I would guess 6, but that's just a shot in the dark.
Is he right?
How many?
What'd you say?
6.
6.
No.
Nope. Well, you got a free oil change anyway, Alan.
Thank you very much. I'll be by to pick it up.
Hey, Alan.
Yes, sir.
I'll give you the tire rotation, and I want to tell everybody what it was, because we only have just a few minutes left anyway. Most of them ran on 120 volts.
Wow.
They actually had an inverter built into the car just to run the opera lights.
So they're on house power.
Yes, sir. They had an inverter that changed to 12 volts DC current to 120 volt AC current.
Just for that little light.
Just for that little light.
Wow.
That's a place not to write your name in the snow.
That's right, yeah. And you know where Sunrise Automotive is, right?
I do.
Okay, well, I'm sure Matt, just introduce yourself to Matt and he'll take care of you.
Pleasure speaking with you, Matt.
Thank you, sir.
There you go, you know. Yeah, those little tiny strips of light on the side of a car.
Yep.
Wow, so much power. Why? What were they thinking?
You know what? They didn't want you messing with them either. Don't mess with them. You take them off, and they were sealed units that if a bulb went bad in an Opera light, you bought the whole assembly. You didn't buy just a bulb. It came as a whole assembly, completely sealed. There was something inside of them that they really didn't want us to mess around with too much.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
I mean, especially, maybe technology of that day made it necessary, but technology today, you could put a little LED in there and
it
would make...
And you remember the old cars with the... they had optic fibers. Optic fiber was big in, you know, a lot of the luxury cars, and so that you could... You know, they would have an optic fiber come off your lens and go into the back of your headliner, so you could look in your rearview mirror and touch your brake, and you see those little red lights light up.
Oh, I know what you mean. Yeah.
Today they're all done with LCD lighting, and they're all done electrically. Years ago, they were done with optic fibers.
Oh, I gotcha. Oh, really?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
So they could transfer that light a long, long ways.
We love our cars, don't we?
I do.
Have you ever been to L.A.? They say L.A. is the city that loves their cars the most.
I've been to L.A. once when I was real, real small, when I was a little guy.
Uh-huh.
And then I've been into the airport a couple of times, but I've never just hung out there.
Yeah. It's the one place I didn't love my car.
You didn't love your car?
No, because there was just too many of them.
Yeah.
Well, it's not fun to drive when there's a million people all around you.
See, I won't drive in New York City. We go there.
I don't either.
We go there quite often, and... And I'm not driving.
I don't either. I grew up there, and I made the mistake of driving in the city a few times, but I don't do it anymore. When I go up there, I park at a train station, take the train in.
Yeah.
Or
that's the way I do it. We take those double-decker buses.
Oh, do you?
Yeah, we go all over in them double-decker buses.
Well, see, because I have an advantage knowing the area. I know where I can park for free. Most people would probably be better off if they found a place where it costs $20 or $30 to park.
Yeah.
Just that way your car is safe and you can get around. Well, anyway, so I'm thinking of a Jeep. You know, that would be a vehicle. If you park that in a bad neighborhood in New York, what's the worst that could happen?
The worst you could have? You come back to a shell.
But, I mean, they can't steal anything from it. I mean, it's all open anyway. You're not going to put anything anyway.
You'd be surprised what they could steal out of a Jeep. And that would probably be a pretty... Really? That'd be a...
You think they'd be taking stuff out of my Jeep? They see the Florida license plate, right?
Yeah.
They see me getting out in my flowered shirt and my shorts and my camera.
You'd be surprised how much stuff is in there. I know. And I'm telling you, I'm speaking from experience. I had taken these two Jeeps, and I had to swap everything from one Jeep to another Jeep.
Really?
Everything.
Because of vandals?
No, because that's what the customer wanted.
Oh, okay.
I want this Jeep to have these seats, this interior, this carpet, this dash, this everything, and we swapped them over. Don't really know why we did it.
You know, another thing that you don't see on cars anymore, I was just thinking about the ornament hood.
Right.
I mean, the hood ornament.
Right.
The hood ornament.
Yeah.
Whatever happened to that?
I guess that's kind of that trendy, that...
You
know, that went away. Now it's on the car.
They almost look like family crap. No, I told you about the car with the door open, right? There was no labeling on it. I couldn't find anything other than the frame of the license plate that even told me it was a Ford. And when I told you that story last week, I was glad to find out you would have had a hard time, too.
I would have had a hard time.
Always a fun show, man. It's always amazing how I enjoy this show. Auto repair with personal care. Let's see. Sunrise Automotive is where you would go to see Matt, and that's at 1800 Northwest 10th Street. The phone number over there
is 690-1993.
And I'll be by for an oil change. Maybe not today. Can I just show up, or do I need an appointment?
No, you can show up.
Just show up. Okay. And of course, if you need a landmark, how do we tell people where you are? 1800 Northwest.
If you'll head down 27, Highway 27, like if you're going to the interstate, and you get to the light at Martin Luther King Boulevard, I'm the fourth building on the left.
There you go. Can't miss it. It says it right outside, Sunrise Automotive. Thank you, man.
Thank you, Larry.
We will take a break and be right back.
It's Gene Powell Pasture Mowing. Our tractor services include bush hog, disking, front end loader, box blade, and stump grinding. We also have zero turn mowers for the smaller paddocks, aisleways, fence rows, and lawn care. Fence row spraying is also available for weed control.